So the IMF just lifted the global GDP outlook this year to 3% from a 2.8% forecast in April, citing U.S. stability. However, risks from high rates, sticky inflation, and sluggish China recovery linger. Joining us to help put this in context for the Philippines is China Bank Chief Economist Domini Velasquez. Hi, Domini. Finally, good to have you on the show.
Hi, Mimi. Good morning.
Good morning. So apparently, this economic storm that's brewing is not as bad as many feared, huh? Well, 3% is still lower than the 3.8% average growth in the last two decades pre-COVID. It's still not as bad as imagined, right?
Yes, not as bad. I think generally, if you look at advanced economies, their views have actually already improved. For example, for the US, which we follow closely, right? They're now expecting a soft landing, not expecting a recession anytime soon. Similarly, in the UK, I think you do have some countries who might enter into recession, Germany, New Zealand, but very, very few now.
Mm-hmm. And to the extent, so you don't think this is going to be a global recession?
Largely, no. Okay. In advanced economies, US will be the largest one. In China, you have, I guess, modest growth of around 5% from the IMF. In emerging economies in ASEAN, largely higher growth rates also.
But to the extent that you think a slowdown mm-hmm. is coming, at least a slowdown, when does it come significantly and what does it look like for the Philippines? How are we going to be impacted? I mean, even if you're the best looking house in the neighborhood, if the neighborhood is in bad shape, that's going to have impact, right?
Yes, of course. If you look at, I guess, the things that we watch out for, U.S. Economy, not just this year, but next year, if the Fed will keep interest rates quite high until next year, of course, that will impact businesses. China is also a big factor. We've seen Chinese slowdown in terms of manufacturing, in terms of we expected tourist arrivals to come in this year, but turns out not so much, right, from Chinese tourists arriving in the ASEAN region. For the Philippines, generally, if you compare us to other ASEAN countries, we're more insulated in terms of external shocks, just because, you know, we have smaller trade, external trade, merchandise trade, as, let's say, compared to Thailand, Singapore, Vietnam. So the Philippine economy largely rests on domestic consumption, which we think is still going to be resilient for the year.
Mm-hmm. Domestic consumption and services.
Yes, that's true.
Mm-hmm. Whether that's exporting service through OFW, who sent back remittances, or the IT BPM sector, or tourism as well. Domini, you know, today we are getting budget balance that's in the calendar for the Philippines today. We know that we saw in the first quarter deficit narrowing by 15% to 271 billion. Do you expect this trend, this narrowing trend, to continue? And will that be because of increased revenue or a more tamed down spending?
Well, we're seeing both. So I think Secretary Chokno just mentioned revenue target growing by around maybe more than 7% for the first half of the year. That's actually a lot more. That's actually more than the program. So it was 1.9 trillion pesos. Program for the first half is 1.8. So well and good for revenue side, right? I mean, you do have tax administration measures being put in place, some computerization in BIR, BOC. However, expenditures still quite slow. I think Jan to May, it was growing at just a little bit above 1%. So budget last year, you expect expenditures to grow by 5% for this year, right? So still very slow in terms of spending. So it means government must catch up in the second half of the year, whether through more projects, increase absorption in government agencies.
Mm-hmm. All right. And are there concrete steps that you think, you know, investors or businesses might be expecting government take to make this work?
Just yesterday, for example, you mean spending for the government?
Yeah.
All right. Government spending, I think largely, if you look into the details, infrastructure is already up. It's actually higher than projection. Current operating expenditures in terms of government expenses on your personal services, on MOOE, that's actually falling behind. So there is a need to ramp that up. In terms of investors looking into investing in the Philippines, of course, just yesterday in the post, Sona, Secretary Jokno was saying that we need to digitize not just government transactions, because it helps in the ease of doing business and it makes us competitive to other ASEAN countries.
And Dominie, speaking of investors here in the Philippines, how are you thinking about FDIs, foreign direct investments, in the context of the economy we're living in today? I mean, people, companies, whole countries have demonstrable worries about what the next year or two will be looking like amid all the externalities that put pressure on things. So how are you viewing FDIs today?
Well, FDIs have remained quite sluggish, really, because you have high interest rates. I mean, it's happening globally, so you don't expect FDIs to come into the Philippines. Good thing, though, we do have hard-earned structural reforms in place already in terms of liberalizing industries. So you have the Retail Trade Liberalization Law, the pub amendments to the Public Services Act, and renewable energy, where they redefined the IRR to allow 100% renewable energy. And for renewable energy, that's what we're seeing. We're seeing a lot of FDIs coming into renewable energy, which is actually a good sign. But these reforms, it does not happen overnight. It will take maybe 2 years to really reap the benefits of these reforms.
2 years sounds like a pretty short time. Others are expecting 5, 10 years. But all right. So, every year, countries all over the world compete for some $1 trillion in FDIs. How well do you think can the Philippines corner that funding? Do you see us significantly taking a bigger slice of the pie? I mean, you look at
Hopefully.
Vietnam, you look at Thailand, Malaysia, their FDI numbers are just so far from ours.
That's true. In the past few years, we've actually seen huge increases in FDI numbers. Of course, we're really coming from a low base. So these structural reforms, they're doing a lot. They're really game changers. In terms of course, the attractiveness of the Philippines, that's really in the ease of doing business, in lowering your electricity costs so that manufacturing companies would come to the Philippines, and not just BPOs that we've been relying on for a long time. So those things that are being addressed right now should benefit the Philippines medium term.
All right, but in the short term, how short? Before 2 a.m. Thursday morning, the Fed will be announcing its policy rate decision. You think it will be a one and done, or one more coming in September? And more importantly, how does that put pressure, if at all, on the Philippine Central Bank?
Well, for the Fed, I think largely, of course, financial markets are thinking it's just one more, just because you had a very good CPI in June, right? If you look at the CPI number in the US, they had 3% inflation rate. But the Fed Chair Powell has been emphasizing the need to really look into core inflation. So for this time, core inflation really was a lot lower. So month on month, for the past few months, core inflation was at 0.4%. It was stubbornly there. And then for June, it came down to 0.2% month on month. So core inflation is now below 5% for the US. However, again, one inflation print will not dictate the rest of the monetary tightening or the monetary policy stance of the US. We think, of course, one more. We take guidance from the Fed, but we are also open to thinking that there will be two more, and then extending this rate hike cycle until maybe second half of next year.
Wait, let me get
Oh,
that straight.
mid next year. Yeah.
Let me get that straight. So after Thursday's rate hike, you expect two more?
No, just one more.
Just one
Maybe
more. All
an
right.
additional one more in September or November.
And what are you expecting from the Banco Central?
Well, given the really very good trajectory of inflation moving downwards, we're also confident that it's going to be below 4% by October. We think the BSP has done enough. They don't need to do anything more, although you do have that thinning interest rate differentials, right? We're now at 100 basis points. Another hike this week from the Fed will narrow this to 75 basis points differential. However, towards the end of the monetary tightening cycle, that we already know that the Fed is going to do one or two more rate hikes and nothing after that, just hold after that. We think this 100 basis points differential that was a sweet spot last year, the BSP can actually tolerate a smaller rate differential. But again, you know, in terms of rate cuts for the BSP, we think they'll have to wait until the Fed telegraphs that they're already on the way to cutting. So that's going to be next year, maybe mid next year.
All right, all right. And before we let you go, Dominique, just wanted to get your base case for GDP growth. So you think inflation will fall back below 4% by October. What about GDP growth? Are you seeing us staying above 6% this year and next, even beyond?
For us, a little bit lower than the government's target. So for this year, around 5.8%, near that 6%. So if Q2 is actually quite good, we might reach that 6% target of the government. For next year, we share the same view as the IMF. You know, high interest rates will impact economic growth, of course. So next year, we're a little less bullish at 5.5%.
5.8 this year, 5.5 next. Hopefully, by 2025, the numbers go back up above 6% again. Dominique,
should be.
All right. Dominique, pleasure to speak with you. Thank you so much for the insights this morning and for the time. Have a great day.
Thank you.